second going on. Well, their faith held out and they gave a shout. There's a whole lot of shaking going on. Is greater far than tongue or pen could ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell, the guilty pair bow down with care. God gave his son to his erring child.
Strong is healing hand. Then one day his chance came along, a healing man who can make him strong. And he called his eyes, but his question took him by surprise. Do you want to be well? Your mat and help yourself. Do you want to be free? Really want to be free? If you want to be healed and whole, you gotta want to be well. You ever tried to fix yourself? And every time you fell,
then you wallowed in,
drowning in your own despair. Have you gotten used to the chains? Are you so attached to the pain you're afraid to part? And ask the man for a brand new heart. Do you want to be well? Up your mat and help yourself. Do you wanna be free? Really wanna be free? If you wanna be healed and whole, you gotta wanna be well. There's a better life waiting just for you. Take up your mat and help yourself. Do you want to be free? Really want to be free? If you want to be healed and whole, you gotta want to be well. If you want to be healed and whole, you gotta want to be well.
Good morning. Would you join me in worship this morning as we open our service with Holy, Holy, Holy.
Holy, Holy, Holy.
God's word this morning comes from Revelation chapter 1. And the word of God says this, starting in verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his bondservants the thing which must soon take place. And he sent and communicated it by his angel to his bondservant John, who testified to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even to all that he saw. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of the prophecy and heed the things which are written in it, for the time is near. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and released us from our sins by his blood. And he has made us to be a kingdom and priest to his God and Father. To him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn over him. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. The word of God for the people of God. You may be seated.
Second person in the Trinity. He is the Alpha. All praise rise, King Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, the name above every name. Lord, there's the descriptions of you are just endless. Lord, you are matchless. Lord, you are sovereign. You are majestic. You are holy. You are righteous. You are true. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the Prince of Peace, the Lord of Lords, and the King of Kings. So, Father, we bow before you today in our hearts. We rejoice in our souls. Lord, we know that every promise that you have spoken, because of your power, because of your authority, you will perfect it and you will perform it. You will cause all things to work together for our good, for your glory, for your purposes, for your plans. So I thank you, Lord, for the body of Christ. I thank you for churches all over the land. I thank you for Christians who are not ashamed to proclaim Jesus Christ is Lord and to live for your glory. I thank you, Lord, that you're a God that still calls people. You're a God that still moves and a God that still works. You call people out of the darkness. You call people into the light. You call people into purpose, into meaning. So, Father, we thank you that we have been the recipients of such grace and such mercy. And, Lord, as our service has begun, our worship pours out to you with gratitude and thanksgiving. Lord, hallowed be thy name. Move in this service. Fulfill your good and pleasing and perfect will. I humbly, sincerely ask and pray in the name of King Jesus. Let's stand together. Let's sing about the goodness of God. The goodness of God.
From the moment
Thanks be to God. Take a moment to greet your fellow worshipers today. We do have some information here about our church. If anybody would like to find out about Mount Sinai and you're visiting, let us know. We'll be happy to get that to you. Grace and peace. Welcome to Mount Sinai Baptist Church.
Your move.
Huh?
Your move.
You want to see me groove? I haven't danced in years.
No, it's your move in checkers.
Oh, right.
You know something? This game always reminds me.
There's nothing behind you.
I said reminds me.
Oh, what does checkers remind you of?
VBS.
PBS. Yes, I watch PBS every night.
No, VBS. The one we did in 2023, Twists and Turns.
Twist and Turn. That's how I get out of bed every morning.
That was my favorite theme ever. It was all about games.
Oh, yes, I remember. Games like checkers.
Board games, strategy games, video games.
Oh, my. You know, kids these days, they've really got it made.
Yeah, there's so much to do at VBS. They even get a full meal.
Yeah, when we were kids, we only got 2 cookies and a small cup of Kool-Aid, and we liked it.
But most of all, I remember the theme verse. Make your ways known to me, Lord. Teach me your paths. Psalms 25:4.
You remember that after all this time?
I sure do. Twists and Turns. VBS was one of the best weeks of my childhood. It was so much fun, and it taught me so much about Jesus.
I do remember that week. Actually, hold on a second. There's something I've kept.
What's that?
It's the VBS postcard invitation we got in the mail. I've kept it all these years.
I'll remember those dates forever. And how did we sign up?
Well, I think we scanned the QR code in the bulletin, or we saw Brandy out front.
Let's finish this checkers game and then break out some more games to remember the good times of VBS 2023.
That sounds great, but I may need a nap first.
We have some talented folks around here, don't we? Amen. Well done. Well done. So we put a lot into VBS. Brandy and her team do an extraordinary job trying to just make the kids create an environment that it's just so easy for them to take in all God has for them. So appreciate your prayer support, and it's coming quick. Next Sunday it begins, so hope that you'll be a part of that. I want to wish Janet Ledbetter a happy birthday today as she celebrates a birthday, and also grateful for the rain that we've had. And just felt led this morning to say I'm grateful for our teachers and our educators, as they've had a full year working with the students, and it's coming down to the end of the wire. So just grateful for if you're an educator working in the public school system, why don't you stand for us? Let's give you a hand today. Go ahead. We got several. Yes. Amen. Amen. They're on the fire lines 24/7. Well, they're on their lot. So we appreciate them, and they work hard. Want to go over some prayer concerns with you today. Want to, John Wayne, our good friend John Wayne, goes to see the heart doctor on Tuesday. If you get your pen out, you might want to make a note or two of who you can pray for, who you can encourage in the Lord. These are ministry opportunities I'm getting ready to go over that you can reach out and care for people and let them know you're thinking about them. Michael K. Hamrick, as he continues his preparation and dealing with the prostate cancer that he has. Bill Champion, still having some side effects from his stroke. Janice Moorhead was dealing with COVID, and Paul and Nikki had it, her daughter and son-in-law, and they had a relapse, I understand. Eric Rom's with us today. Welcome back, Eric. He's still recovering from his retina surgery, and praying things will continue to improve and get a little better for him. Brandy Hamrick, Roger Hamrick's wife, has some upcoming surgery they're trying to get scheduled. If you remember Brandy, she's been referred back to the oncologist specialist to hopefully get into surgery sooner. Pray that that'll happen. She's been having a lot of pain dealing with some fibroid issues. Also, Ashley Stroop is still in the hospital, and Lizzie's here today in Lake, and as soon as she gets out, they get to head to the beach. So they're praying awful hard for their mama. But Ashley is dealing with diverticulitis. She's in the hospital in Kings Mount. So I know they'd appreciate prayers. CJ Brooks has been having some seizures. We'll remember CJ. Vicki Belger goes June 2nd to see her surgeon. Martha Evans, which Martha is also our shut-in of the week. We'll put her picture back up. This is Julie Hamrick's mother, Martha Evans. Shut-in of the week instead of young adult of the week. Did you catch that? Amen. We love them no matter how young they are or how old they are, right? We want to take care of our people and minister to them. Found out this week that she actually had some hernia surgery, so we'll be praying for her as she recovers from this hernia surgery, as well as she deals with chronic back pain. So church on the move tonight, we're going to have the opportunity, church in or church out. Church will be on the move, in or out. If you go with us, we're going to go see Miss Martha and sing, encourage her a little bit, pray for her. If you want to come help Brandy and the team prepare for Vacation Bible School, they could use some more help, so that'll be an opportunity tonight as well. David Bolton will be going to the Sanger Clinic to see a vascular specialist. So he's got an aneurysm, I think it's at 5.1, that they're going to be evaluating, so that's David. Meadow Glenn goes Thursday to Charlotte to see a specialist. April has surgery on June the 8th. Cody and Jenna are here. Y'all got any plans this weekend?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's right. They're getting married this weekend, so we'll be praying for you guys and your families as y'all celebrate this wonderful holy matrimony of marriage. And also then we want to be, got word this morning, Dean Bridges is having a lot of pain in his neck. We pray for him. Our search committee for our new secretary, our VBS workers and staff, our mission trip training, Pastor Bob Conrad, this pastor we're working with, he's having some health issues. And Edwin, Norma Weaver's grandson, is facing some surgery this next week. Mike Sapalt, got to see Mike last evening. He had a little bit of a setback. He's dealing with some pneumonia, as well as they did some x-rays on his stomach, hoping he doesn't have a blockage of some sort in his bowel. So we'll be praying for Mike and Carol. And Lisa's with her sister, Joanna. She's been in the hospital in Charlotte this weekend, and Lisa's up there with her now, so praying she'll be able to come home later today. And then I wanted to mention also, next Sunday, we'll be recognizing Denise Ledbetter, 17 years of service here at Mount Sinai Baptist Church. So you can bring a gift card, a card of appreciation. We'll have a basket here. You can put it in next week or give to the love offering. Just put Denise Ledbetter, but we'll recognize her next Sunday. So it's quickly approaching. So next Sunday we want to celebrate Denise and her ministry here through the years. So those are several prayer concerns for you to be mindful of. But of course, this is Memorial Day weekend, and we want to remember those who have given the ultimate sacrifice for our country. And I wanted to share with you a thought about that as well. I know we had Nell Frazier, Meldine Frazier. It's one of our members that was died in service, and I know you know of individuals as well, but I like what President Franklin D. Roosevelt said 1 week after Pearl Harbor attack. Those who long enjoy such privileges that we enjoy forget in time that others have died to win them. Freedom is never really free. It's almost always bought with blood that some individual spilled for others. With that being on our heart and mind, let's take have a moment of silence as we remember the many who have spilled their blood, given the ultimate sacrifice for our country, for our freedoms. So let's have a moment of silence. Father, on this Memorial Day weekend, we remember the countless lives of individuals who paid the ultimate sacrifice to defend our freedom, to stand for what America stands for. Many of their family members, Lord, still alive, deeply miss them, still live with that pain and that reality, that visit, that phone call, that text message, Lord, that letter in the mail that they received. So, Father, we remember them as well and pray for your provision for them. And, Lord, may we be mindful as well of the stewardship that we have, what we have been entrusted with, to be responsible citizens, God-fearing citizens, that we too would stand for truth and liberty and justice for all. Father, we love you. We thank you that ultimately, Lord, we know that you are the ultimate life giver, that you provided the ultimate sacrifice. Though you were sinless, though you did not have to, you chose to lay down your life to redeem a ruined race, Adam's ruined race. Greater love has no man than this, than a man lay down his life for his friends. Father, we are grateful and we are thankful. It's in your holy name I offer this prayer. Amen. Well, happy to introduce to you today Sophie Foster. Sophie is one of our own. She is a student at UNCW. God has been working and moving in Sophie's life, and I'm so happy to be able to introduce her and let you hear about some of the activity of God in her life and her next step. You know, we're big about taking the next step to experience God and fulfill His plans and purposes, and she is taking her next step, and we have the privilege to get in on it and to participate with it. Sophie, tell us how God's moving and working in your life.
Good morning, everyone. It's so good to stand up here today and to see all of you. I want to thank Pastor Tim for gifting me the time to be up here and to share what the Lord has been up to in my life the past 2 years. As many of you know, my name is Sophie Foster, and I attend UNCW in Wilmington right at the beach. When I chose this school, I truly had no real reason to go there. I really didn't. It didn't stand out to me in any way. When it came down to it, I just needed to choose a school. But I now know why I went there. The first semester I was there, I was in a way suffering from these reflections that I didn't have anything in my life to hold on to for consistent comfort, truth, and reliability. Peace was not near me, and I didn't have that always in my life, like a battery in life that never goes out. And that is because then I was not fearing Jesus or walking with Him intimately and hadn't quite seen what it meant to see His light and way and be in it. But that first semester I did. Now it seems like a blur and feels like God sucked me up in this redemptive vacuum. I'm really with the Lord now. As Pastor Tim mentioned to me the other day, the Lord draws us to Himself. And that word draw literally means to drag. And He dragged me back hard. I was so lost, but thank God for His loving kindness and patience. So over the next year, I was walking close with the Lord. I got involved with Crew Campus Ministries at my school, which many of you know as Campus Crusades for Christ. I have now committed to being a part of their staff part-time in the fall, for my last semester at UNCW, and then full-time in the spring of 2024 after I graduate in December. A funny part of all of this is that I told my friend about 7-ish months ago that I just couldn't see myself working for Crew and that I probably would never do it. And you see exactly where that led. It's still so funny to me that I said that because I'm fully in mode with Crew now. But being involved with Crew over the last year allowed me to see how ministry truly works. Evangelism, discipleship, planning ministry events, creating hospitable spaces, counseling students, and I fell in love with how Crew does ministry with college-age students. I want to work with people my age. I love them. Through small groups, outreaches, out-of-town conferences, Crew's resources, and our large group meetings, the Lord graciously gifted me new revelation after revelation. I fell in love with the wisdom of God and how His word allows me to encourage and to edify. Only through His wisdom does knowledge feel right and make sense. The last year at UNCW, I have seen how people have been reborn, been saved, been given their eternal inheritance, rediscovered the Lord through Crew, and because of Crew, have been giving a caring community passionate to connect them with Jesus and a family of great people. Many weeks it was Crew's small groups and experiencing the word in the same way with other believers that truly kept me going. I know God has deposited a piece of His heart into all of us in this room. And just like how every one of you take great joy and how you specifically serve others with the Spirit of Christ, I truly want to serve people within Crew and students at UNCW. Wilmington, just like many campuses, is very free-spirited. Through outreaches and my own conversations with many of my friends and other students there, there is this craving and worldview many students have that any path is the good path, and that all of these truths can add up to become the truth and to be the truth, that there isn't a standard for beauty and truth and decisions. It's an every which way type of ordeal when choosing how to see life. And just like many other campuses as well, The second burden on my campus is that people are on the verge of experiencing Jesus, but have never been approached about his nature, the reality of who he is and what he has done. It's a blank slate, and they need someone in Christ, through Christ's power, to paint the grand picture. A lot of this unknownness about our Savior, based on what students have told me, is that their parents don't believe, they've never been approached by anyone because deep conversation about life never happens, or they just haven't ever been told. And when these introductory deep meaning life combos have happened with me and other students and other people, I have seen that these students and my friends who haven't been surrounded by combos of Jesus immediately jump into the reality of what their life is and the life God gives to them freely. My main three visions for these burdens in joining the staff team for CREW is to reach UNCW students in life-giving conversations, allowing my conversations to offer a home, to offer a space where something fruitful can occur and they can feel heard and acknowledged, to do initiative evangelism and relational evangelism, which I really want to grow in, just by meeting people, by going out on campus weekly and sharing the gospel through CREW's resources, initiating with people I do not know by God's guidance in that exact moment, and also reaching my non-believing friends at the school through relational ways of getting together and doing something with them every week. The third vision is building people groups, especially with young women, within CREW itself through the Word of God, by strengthening young women with the Word of truth and the identity God has given us and the plan he promises for each of us. Community is crucial. For me to hold this position in CREW, I have to raise $40,000 by August 1st. I have about 50% of that total raise at the moment. Giving to CREW is tax deductible, and every single staff member who works for CREW Ministries has to fund for their own ministry journeys because the organization relies on all of their financial income to come from concerned individuals, churches, families, and businesses. In a big way, CREW staff are supported is through partnerships. I'd love to have a partnership with any of you who are in a season where this is possible for you and allows you to joy in the Lord. This partnership would look like giving a certain amount per month that the Lord lays on your heart that starts this month or any time before August the 1st and continues monthly for the next year until I make the decision if I want to continue with CREW again or to venture into another opportunity. One option is to give by check. I do have envelopes right in front of the pew, already filled out with my account number if anyone loves to pay by check. And I also have ministry letters here today as well that provide the link to my give site online with options of giving by checking account or credit card. This is done through my account page, and I never handle or touch any of my funds, but instead it goes straight to CREW's higher-ups where it is handled professionally. What I do understand and acknowledge with extreme humility is that partnerships are not always realistic for everyone. I really want to highlight today that one-time donations, monthly prayer, and monthly encouragement takes a hold of all of my gratitude just as much as a partnership. All support of any kind is for the Lord's namesake. I have chosen at this point in my life to be a vessel for God, so truly, any support you give is for the glorious expanse of the kingdom and for the purpose of more people to become children of God. If you do feel called to support me in any form, I want giving to feel right and timely because it makes you excited and pumped up for Jesus. I will have a monthly newsletter that goes out to everyone who is on my support team, prayer team, and encouragement team. I will also stay in touch regularly and invest in your lives through prayers, phone calls, and many other forms of conversation. I'll be up front after service if any of you have any questions or just want to talk about anything at all. I am in awe of the Lord that I am able to get up in front of a home church who has loved on me over the past decade. To even be able to do that is a rich gift in itself. Every detail of this church and detail of this church family, I could appreciate. I have meditated on to appreciate in my heart. To end on this quote seems fitting, as I know all of you can relate. Who I was and who I now am is proof that our Lord Jesus Christ is real. Thank you, Mount Sinai, and to the saints here for everything you have done for me.
The, you know, this is really what we're all about, is it not? I mean, make disciples who make disciples. We've heard the past several years how students are leaving the church when they go off to school. When they graduate, they're just walking away. And God has given us a chance to invest in somebody who's on a college campus where a culture that truly needs the hope and the purpose and the meaning of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I think it's a great privilege we have to invest in a missionary, putting a missionary on the campus of UNCW. And so I strongly encourage you, and I am a check writer, so I picked up one of these, but there are other ways to give. But if you have any questions for Sophie, she'll be happy to answer those. But this is a great opportunity for us to invest in eternal things, to invest in the kingdom, to come along beside one of our own that wants to be an everyday missionary, right where God placed her, right where God put her. So let me pray for you, and then we'll continue. Lord, thank you so much for your call. Lord, thank you for the good work that you begun in Sophie years ago, and thank you for how you are perfecting that, how you are growing that. Thank you for how she has said, yes, Lord, to that question, Lord, what do you want me to do? Just months ago, she said, well, I would never do this. Thank you, Lord, for her submission to your lordship. Father, that you have called her and made it clear what she needed to do, Lord. And now you've brought this opportunity to us to invest in one of your own, to invest in ministry, right, Lord, up close and personal on a college campus, Lord, where so many people desperately need to know about the plan of salvation, a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, the hope. Thank you for the vision that you've given Sophie, Lord. So we commit her to you. We gladly participate with her and pray, Heavenly Father, you would bring many to saving faith to your son through her faithful obedience. I humbly ask and pray in the name of King Jesus. Amen. Amen. So Sophie will be down front after the service. And if you're interested in picking one of these up at any point in the service, you can come pick one of those up. And if you have any other questions. So this time I'll call on Randy to come offer our offertory prayer.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for everyone that has gathered in your house today, Lord. Thank you for the many blessings that you give us. Thank you, Lord, for your grace and your peace. Thank you, Lord, for the words we have just heard from Sophie, and thank you for the desire and the calling that you have placed on her heart, Lord. As the offerings are brought before you, Lord, I just pray that we will use them as in a way that you see fit, Lord. And in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
So much, choir, Joy, Annette, and Dana. Thanks be to God. As the choir is finding their seats and children are leaving for children's church, I do have one announcement I failed to make. Who? Ladies of Mount Sinai. What? LOL dinner gathering. When? This coming Saturday, June 3rd at 6 p.m. Where? La Bella Vita Restaurant in Bowling Springs. Questions, contact Lynn Lavender. The ladies are up to it again. They're meeting Saturday, June the 3rd, 6 o'clock. If you have any questions, they'd love to have you, whether you've been able to make any of their meetings or not. It's a great, great time to grow in community and fulfill the purposes of God as His church. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thank You for the wonderful music today, the wonderful spirit of worship. The opportunity to draw near to You, the opportunity to respond to You, to respond to Your activity, the opportunity to see Your activity in the lives of others. Lord, You're always up to good in the lives of Your children. You're always up to good in the lives of lost people, pointing them to Your Son so they can be saved. So, Father, I pray as we open up the Word of God, You would mold us. Renew our minds, shape us, help us to live with a sense of urgency, help us to see what You want us to see. Lord, help us to love what You would have us to love so we can begin to hate what You hate. Father, grace us now for this appointed time in the Word of God. I humbly, sincerely ask in the name of King Jesus. Amen. Please take your personal copy of the Word of God, turn to the Revelation chapter 1. We return to our study, Unveiling the Future. Here in Revelation chapter 1, title of the message today, Jesus in Glory Part 2. Got part 1 done weeks ago, but we're up to part 2 today. John, the beloved disciple, one of the 12, an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, banished in prison, put on the Isle of Patmos, the local Alcatraz of the day, because of his devotion to the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says that he was put there because he was a faithful witness, because he followed the Lord Jesus Christ, because of the Word of God. John obeyed God and left all the consequences up to him. Sound familiar? Charles Stanley. Just, well, that's what he said oftentimes. Obey God, leave all the consequences. By the way, on this Memorial Day weekend, as we think about soldiers who have been faithful to the government, to the nation, and have gone all out to fulfill and pay the ultimate sacrifice, how much more should we as followers of King Jesus be willing to pay a price to follow him and to honor him in our nation, in our world, in your schools, in your homes? You know, the price is something that we need to be willing to pay. And in our society, the opportunity is increasing for us to be able to stand up and take notice of what the Lord desires for us. So good to see you today. I'm just now making the connection. Chuck, your mother's here. Grace, she watches us online. And I'm so glad you got to see your son sing in person today. Welcome. God bless you. What a privilege to have Chuck and his wife in our church. So John is being faithful to the Lord Jesus Christ, and he's willing to pay the price. So the question is, have you been a faithful witness this past week? We're all witnesses. The question is, what kind of witness are we? Are we a witness for the world, or are we a witness for the Word? And so we all have opportunities. Sometimes we fail, but when we fail, we need to acknowledge, Lord, I totally blew that. This happened to me many times. Lord, I'm sorry. I missed that opportunity. Lord, forgive me for not speaking up for you. Lord, have mercy on me. But guess what? God forgives. God forgives me. God forgives us and gives us another opportunity. And he can use it for good when we surrender it to him. So John the Apostle was living out just as Jesus did. He was following Jesus' example as a faithful witness, and it cost him. But here's a good word. God, his eye is always on his servants. John's gospel goes on to tell us back, he says, God honors those who honor him. And so John had no idea that in his pain, in his suffering, in his banishment, on the Isle of Patmos, that God was going to do a supernatural work that we would be talking about today. We would be benefiting today. We would be encouraged. We'd be strengthened because of what he encountered, because of what he went through. He got a vision, an unveiling of the future, an unveiling of the Lord Jesus Christ that encouraged his heart. Are you dealing with the Isle of Patmos yourself? I mean, right now, it's just not making any sense whatsoever what you're dealing with, what you're going through. You don't see anything good coming out of it. God sees you. God will not abandon you. God will help you through whatever you're dealing with. God can do something so beyond what you think. John had no idea. He didn't think he was ever going to get off the Isle of Patmos. But when Domitian died, we believe that John was able to go back to Ephesus for a while. But he got to behold something and see something that was just beyond belief. And that's what God will do in your life as well. So John, I love this. On the Lord's day, he was in the place of blessing. He was in the Spirit. And when he was in the Spirit on the Lord's day where he should have been, he heard something. He saw something, and then he did something. Now that's where we miss out a lot, right? We might hear it, we might see it. How many times do we come in worship? How many times does God bring a witness before us and we hear it, we see it, but we don't do anything with it? You know, when God opens your eyes, that's your invitation to get in on what he's doing. So when we come, we hear, we see. The question is, what do we do? James said, be a doer of the word, not just a hearer of the word. Because John did do what he did do, he recorded it, he wrote it down, we are benefited from it today. Here's our simple outline from chapter 1, verses 9 through 20. Number one, the circumstances of the vision. We've already dealt with this in previous messages. We have the content of the vision, which we will deal with today, and then the consequences of the vision, which we will deal with today. So let's pick it up under the content of the vision. John heard a voice, and he turns to see the voice speaking. Listen to what he recorded about the vision of the glorified Christ, or as your sermon title says, Jesus in glory. Picking it up, John, Revelation chapter 1, beginning at verse 12. Then I turned to see the voice that was speaking with me, and having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. And in the middle of the lampstands, I saw one like a son of man, clothed in a robe reaching to the feet and girded across his chest with a golden sash. His head and his hair were white, like white wool, like snow, and his eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze when it has been made to glow in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of many waters. In his right hand he held seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in its strength. When I saw him, I fell at his feet like a dead man, and he placed his right hand on me, saying, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last, and the living one. And I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of Hades. Therefore, write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after these things. As for the mystery of the seven stars, which you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches." John sees these seven golden lampstands. Verse 20 tells us the seven golden lampstands literally represent seven churches that were existed in their time, in their day, that had problems, they had issues. They were churches, seven churches. Seven represents the number of perfection as well. And also these churches, we can see a little bit of ourselves in some of these churches today. Churches today, they represent some of the churches today. As we read this, as we get into the churches in chapter 2 and chapter 3, we need to be evaluating, where does Mount Sinai fall into this? How do we measure up to what the penetrating gaze and eyes of the Lord see in his church? So these lampstands are a very fitting symbol. It represents to us how Christ sees the church in the world today. Well, what is that, Pastor? The purpose of the church in the world today, we are to bear and reflect the light of Christ. What a fitting description. A lampstand is meant to give light, to dispel darkness, and to show people the way out. That's good. Jesus not only claimed to be the light of the world in John 8:12, he also told his disciples that they would be the light of the world as well. The world is full of people who are lost in darkness, and they don't know their way out. Yesterday I was meditating on my message, looking over my message, and I was reminded of the five-alarm fire that hit South Park in Charlotte a few weeks ago. Immediately, I thought of Matt Rollins. So I called my friend Matt. I said, "Matt, were you working that day?" He said, "No, I was off work." He said, "But my station was called to that fire, station number 2 in Charlotte, where he works." And I was talking to Matt a little bit about a fire, and he said there were about 90 firefighters that went to that fire at South Park. Matt said, "A fire is nothing like what you see on TV." He said, "When you go into a fire, it is pitch black. It is so thick, you cannot see anything. The darkness is just overwhelming, pitch black." He said, "We wear either a helmet light or a light on our jacket." He said, "We have a tracking system." He called it an accountability, a personal accountability tracking system, that if they do not move in 20 seconds, the alarm begins to ring, so they'll have to move if they're okay, so that alarm will stop ringing, but they'll know where they are. So in a fire, when it's pitch black and people are trapped inside, they cannot see to find their way out. They need help. They need individuals who will help them find their way out of what they're dealing with. They need the light. They need someone to come in and show them. Matt said they had 15 rescues that day at South Park, and even the crane operator they had to rescue. They had to lead them and help them to get away from the danger and the deadly nature of fire. What a great picture of the church. There are people that are lost in darkness. There are people who cannot find their way. Just as Sophie said, some of these students have never heard about Jesus. Some of these students have never heard the gospel where the Spirit of God could even penetrate their heart and begin to bear witness. Yes, you need a Savior. Yes, you're guilty of sin. We are the church. We are to be the light. We're to help people find their way out of the darkness, out of the damnation that they will experience due to the eternal darkness of sin. We are the church, and we are to be the light of the church. Jesus is the light of the world, and he's given us that task. Jesus is like the sun, S-U-N, the source of our light. We are like the moon, reflecting his glory. And so Jesus stands in the midst of his church in these seven candlesticks, and he says, the body is designed. You are to be focused on me and abided in me so that you can dispel the darkness and show people the way out. Has your life this week been a light that has dispelled darkness, that has pointed people toward the hope and the help of the Lord Jesus? But also note the location of Christ among the churches. He was in the middle. He was right there in the midst of them. He was not far off somewhere. He's right in the middle of his churches. In other words, Jesus is present here today. He is active among his members. He is here with us. You are not alone. You're not facing your troubles and your trials alone. Jesus, then it says, John says, I saw, or he says, does that message, let me ask you a question. Does that message sound familiar? Hopefully it does. Last week, Joshua 1, 8, and 9, we talked to our graduates. What do we say, graduates? We told you about what true success was, to know and do the will of God. And then we said, do not let this book of the law depart out of thy mouth, but meditate therein day and night that thou mayest observe to do according to all that's written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt be of good success. Have not I commanded you, be strong and of a good courage. Do not be afraid, for the Lord thy God is with you wherever you go. So God does not abandon his people. He saves us by his grace. He sustains us by his grace. He goes with us by his grace. And he walks with us. Just as how encouraging that whether you're a graduate just beginning a new chapter or whether you're a senior saint coming and cruising down toward the end of your life, God is with you. His promises hold true. He is a rock and he's a refuge. Hope abounds in the promises of God when you know the promises of God. I was in Shelby this week and I ran into Patricia Aker. And Patricia lost her husband Harold about 10 months ago. And I was talking to her and she said, we were married at Mount Sinai, me and my husband. We're married at Mount Sinai Baptist Church. I said, really? I didn't know that. And I said, well, we just had our 175th anniversary. She said, yeah, Annette Ledbetter and told me about it. She said, but that's the day Zion, where her membership is now, that's where they were recognizing Harold that Sunday, so I wasn't able to come. But here's what she told me. She said, Pastor, she said, thank you for coming over to speak to me. She said, I don't see how people can make it without the Lord. She said, Harold had colon cancer that turned into pancreatic cancer. And she said it was just a hard season to go through. And she said, I can tell you and testify that I felt the presence of God and the promises of God. She said, I don't know how people make it without the Lord. And so she's bearing witness in this season of life to the promises of God and to the power of his presence. Jesus is here this morning with whatever you're dealing with. He is able to help you and minister to you. Next, John says, I saw one like a son of man. Jesus' favorite title to refer to himself, the son of man. 81 times in the gospel, he refers to himself as the son of man. Only two other times in the New Testament, I believe is correct, that he refers to himself as the son of man. One here in Revelation, and the other one in Acts chapter 7 at the stoning of Stephen. When Stephen looks up into heaven, he says, behold, I see the heavens opened up and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. That Son of Man is a title Jesus would often use to communicate his humanity and the fact that he understands suffering. When we're suffering, we can be mindful that we have a great high priest who can sympathize with us because he has experienced the sufferings that we have as well. So Jesus, even in heaven, he identifies with us. He comes to us. You know, I thought about the Wounded Warrior program that perhaps you've seen advertised and how meaningful that is. Those who've lost a limb in battle, the battle scars of war, they're very real. The horrors of bomb and blast and grenades, gunfire, ambushes. They leave their mark on these soldiers in their service and what they've done. And the horrors, may I remind you, of hell and the scars of sin have left their mark on the Lord Jesus. And in heaven, we will see the Son of Man fully marked for what he did in his triumph, with the nail scars and the piercings that his body went. Next, John sees the robe of Christ. We see his apparel there. A robe is always symbolic of a character. It testifies to the function of the individual who's wearing it. And in Isaiah 6:1, we read, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the glory. The robe mentioned here is a priestly robe. It's similar to the robe of Aaron in Exodus 28:2, designed for glory and beauty. The phrase robe reaching down appears only once in the New Testament and 7 times in the Old Testament, and 6 of those 7 describe the robe of the high priest. And Jesus, the Bible tells us, is our great high priest. The long robe that Jesus, as our great high priest, had, the scripture says there was a golden sash across his chest, which reveals him as the high priest, listen, who goes into the very presence of God to obtain forgiveness of sin for those who have believed. Isn't that a wonderful picture of our Lord going into the Holy of Holies? I've redeemed him. I've redeemed her. My blood has covered them. My atonement is sufficient for them. We see Jesus with this majestic robe as a picture of the great high priest who, as Hebrews tells us, for once and for all paid that price for our redemption. Never get over the fact of Jesus' sacrifice. We see Jesus in the role of cleansing as a high priest, but then we also see Jesus as a high priest interceding for us. The Bible tells us, what a wonderful promise for you to be reminded of today, that Jesus knows exactly what you're facing this week, what's ahead of you, those things that you are dreading, those things that are fearful and uncertain, you're scared about, test results, doctor's appointments, new beginnings, leaving my parents, bills, stress. And Jesus, the Bible says, is interceding for us, praying for us, to encourage us, to lean on him, to trust him, to obey him and to follow him. Out of the blue this week, I got a text message from a ministry leader around the state that I had not heard from in a good long while. Here's what he said. Hey, brother, had you on my heart during my prayer time, praying for you, your family, your ministry, and for the Lord to give you grace and wisdom. Woo! How timely was that message? God moved in a man of God that sent me a message for a situation I was dealing with, just to remind, hey, Tim, I've got this. Be faithful, obey me, trust me, keep trying to honor me. I've got you covered. I go before you, and I live within you. And my God shall meet all of your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. God intersects our lives. God speaks. God is active. He is a communicator. And he does that in many ways, numerous ways, to remind us and show us that he's with us, that he's for us. Through the scriptures, through his servants, through songs, through silence and solitude, through his spirit. God speaks through blessings. God speaks through battles. And God speaks through burdens. Had a conversation with someone this week about a burden they've been having for a while and how helpful it was just to process God's activity when he puts something on you, when he weighs something on you. There's the burdens of everyday life. And then I'm listening to a little podcast of Charles Stanley. He starts talking about burdens and how God uses burdens, 2 types of burdens, everyday burdens, but then the burdens God lays on you for a reason, because he's up to something. You know, we heard some burdens just voiced from this pulpit a little while ago. As Sophie said, I'm burdened about some of my colleagues, some of my peers who think anything goes any way you want it, that it all leads to the same place. But it doesn't. It doesn't. And God's burdened her for her peers. That's the activity of God, Mount Sinai. There are the envelopes right there if you want to get in on something God's up to. Next, we see not only does Jesus, our great high priest, cleanse us, intercede for us, but he inspects us. He inspects us. Let's don't miss this one. 2 Corinthians 5:10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one might receive what is due him for the things done in the body, whether good or bad. 1 Corinthians 3:10 and 11 tell us that we will be judged for our methods, our motives, and our management. Listen to these verses. They all point to God's right and Jesus' right. Jesus is the one that's given the right to rule and to judge us and to evaluate us and to inspect us. Notice it says his hair is white like wool, as white as snow. That's symbolizing his absolute wisdom and justice that he has and possesses as our judge. The next thing we see is Christ's eyes, which are like a flame of fire. Can you imagine the contrast John must have felt? I mean, he'd seen Jesus tear up before. He saw Jesus weeping over Jerusalem. He saw Jesus with tears of compassion in his eyes. And now he's seeing Jesus, and now it's a different type of look. And his eyes aren't filled with tears. They're filled with a penetrating gaze of holiness and justice and righteousness for everything that is not in order. The next thing John sees as he talks about this, he sees his eyes, which see right through him and goes through him. Don't think God is going to overlook your sin. He's not going to weaken sin. God's going to take your stewardship. What he's entrusted to you, your time, your talents, your treasures, he's going to expect a return. He's going to see how faithful you've been with these things. As Hebrews 9:27 tells us, it's appointed a man wants to die. And then judgment. I'm not trying to scare you about judgment, because if you're in the Lord Jesus Christ, you won't be judged for your sin because you were justified in Jesus. That took place at Calvary. But I am informing you, I am teaching you, I am instructing you, I am reminding you that you are responsible once you come to Jesus with what you do, with what he's blessed you with. There's not a lot of teaching going on around here. You are accountable for what's been entrusted to you and the opportunities, the gifts, the talents, the abilities that he has given you. In fact, stewardship matters. If you're a Sunday school teacher, if you're a Wednesday night leader, if you're a children's or youth leader, if you're working in our vacation Bible school, what you're teaching or not teaching will be judged. Every word that comes out of my mouth every Sunday morning, every Wednesday, every day during the week, I will be held to an even higher standard than you are, because I've been called of God to teach his word. So I'm responsible, I'm accountable. And so it's not how I feel about something, it's not my opinion about something, nor is it your opinion. When the word of God says what it means, and it means what it says, don't you dare say, well, God didn't really mean what he just said. That's dangerous, because God did mean what he said. That's why he said it. So no matter what our society and the public opinion is, you need to stick with Scripture. Parents, what are you teaching your children about God? God, those are God's children. He entrusted them to you. I hear parents today tell me things like this. I mean, it's insane. It's insane. Parents will say to me, well, I'm going to let little Billyette grow up and make their own decisions what they want to do, what they want to believe. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? That's a total violation of your responsibility from the Word of God, Deuteronomy chapter 6. God says, teach them to know me, to love me, to follow me, to honor me. You will be held accountable if that's your mindset as a parent or grandparent, that whatever they want to believe, go for it. No, you are to teach them and train them in the way that they should go. Parents, turn your God-given, that's your God-given role. It's not to raise their standard of living, but it's to raise them to fear the Lord. Mount Sinai will be judged on how we obey the Great Commission, how we make disciples who make disciples, how we worship, what we worship, how we focus on worship, our walk and our witness. and how we respond to the activity of God that he brings our way. I'm going to wrap up on this point. Christians will be judged and examined on how we handle our money and our finances. Because where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. God knows that. God knows everything. He sees not only sees in you, he sees through you. And so, do you tithe? Do you honor God with what he's blessed you with? Are we guilty of singing, "Oh, how I love Jesus"? Trust and obey, there's no better way, but we won't give God a dime out of every dollar. We won't give him $1 out of every 10. God will hold us responsible and accountable for what he's graced us with, what he has given to us. And then verse 15, still on the point of judgment, it says, which were his feet, the Lord's feet were like burnished bronze when it has been made to glow in a furnace. Brass in the Bible is a symbol of judgment. The brazen altar was where sin was judged. His feet burning represents they're unstoppable. They're relentless. I found this interesting. In ancient times, kings sat on elevated thrones. So those being judged would come beneath their feet. And the feet of the kings came to refer to authority. And here you have the red hot, glowing feet of the Lord Jesus, who moves throughout the church, exercising his perfect review of our deeds and where we stand and what we teach and what we are doing. I'll wrap up with this passage here. And how fitting it is that he's saying, he's given us this vision of the glorified Christ, and then he moves right into Jesus evaluating the seven churches in chapters 2 and 3. And so he's just setting the stage of his right to rule and to dominate. Let's wrap up at Acts 17. Acts 17. This is a good cross-reference. Acts 17, 30, 31. The Word of God says, therefore, having overlooked the times of ignorance, God is now declaring to men that all people everywhere, that's us, should repent, because he has fixed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness through a man whom he has appointed, the Lord Jesus, having furnished proof to all men by raising him from the dead. The step of approval, the step of authenticity, the step that's everything he ever said is going to come about just as he said, because Jesus came up out of that grave to authenticate every word, and he is the one who will judge. Indeed, it says, what is our responsibility? Therefore, having overlooked the times of ignorance, God said, no longer, no longer. God is now declaring to men that all people everywhere should repent. That's a great Bible word. What's it mean, Pastor? Repent means I'm living my life, I'm doing my thing, and the Holy Spirit convicts me of my sin. I realize what I'm doing wrong, and I stop in my tracks. I say, oh, Lord, have mercy on me. I have sinned. Please forgive me. And I turn, and I about face, and I go in the opposite direction. And I begin to bear fruit, because no longer is the fruit of wickedness and worldliness falling from my life, but now the fruit of godliness is falling from my life. I have repented of my sins. I said, Lord, you're right. I'm sorry for that sin. It's not right. And Lord, no longer. You come to Jesus. You want to repent of that stuff. You don't want to keep that stuff velcroed on your life and keep tolerating that stuff. Doesn't mean you won't stumble, well, you won't fall, but you're not going to try to live a life, a continual life of that stuff. Closing illustration that I heard. Perhaps you've heard it too through the years. In Chicago years ago, there was a nightclub called, well, let me just give you this application. Here's one good point of application. As a result of this renewed vision of the glorified Christ, how does your view of Christ and end times need to change? as these characteristics of Christ, how does your view of where you're heading and what you're facing need to change or be altered? Or how do you need to begin to look at things differently? What changes do you need to make to be consistent with what is coming in the future? Are you lining up under the scriptures? The Bible says Jesus is the keeper of the keys. That means he has the authority. He has the authorities of life and death. In Chicago years ago, there was a nightclub called the Gates of Hell. A nightclub called the Gates of Hell. And there was a man visiting that area. You heard about that, and he was looking for that place, the Gates of Hell. That's where he wanted to go. So there's a stranger he came up on, and he asked the stranger, said, can you tell me how to get to the gates of hell? He said, yes, I can. He said, if you want to go to the gates of hell, what you need to do is you need to go over one block and you need to go down this road. And just so happened there was a church on that road called Calvary. Had a big sign out, Calvary. He said, you need to go over one block and you need to walk right by Calvary and you'll end up at the gates of hell. How true is that, my friends? You don't appreciate and you don't take seriously the price of Calvary and what Jesus did for you. We need to let lost people know Jesus gave it all. He shed his blood so that sinners could be redeemed and we don't have to go to the gates of hell and spend eternity separated from him. We are the light of Christ. We're to bear the light of Christ, share the light of Christ, just as that fire at South Park, darkness engulfed. People had to be let, gone in, rescued out, led out. There are people we know, people we work with, people we're neighbors with that need to know how to get out of the darkness. Let's be faithful with the message that's been entrusted to us. The gospel's come to us, so the gospel can go through us to other people. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I thank you for the message of the gospel. I thank you that you're still calling people to your son so they can be saved. I thank you, Lord, that you still love us unconditionally. We thank you, Jesus, that the price you paid is complete payment once and for all, that we can be totally cleansed. I pray for any lost soul in this building or in the sound of my voice that needs to say for the very first time, Lord, please forgive me. I confess my sin and I turn to you as my personal Lord and Savior. Lord, give them the courage to say, I want to be saved. I want to come to Jesus. And for those of us who do know Jesus, help us to be light in this dark world. Help us to lead people out of the darkness by your grace and by your truth, Lord. Help us to understand the times in which we are living. I humbly, sincerely ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. Our hymn of invitation today, Just As I Am. If you need to trust Jesus as your Lord and Savior today, Andrew will be down to my right, I'll be to my left. If you want to join the church, if you want to be baptized, if you need to come to pray about something, if you need to come pick up an envelope to prayerfully consider supporting Sophie, whatever your desire is, let's stand and sing our hymn of invitation. Amen. Good to be in the Lord's house. I'll leave some of these down here. And Sophie, do you want to stay down here or you want to go out in the vestibule? All right. You go ahead and head out to the vestibule and you can take these with you. You got your helpers here today. It's good to have good helpers. Amen. Well, I hope you have a wonderful Memorial Day weekend. May God grace you and bless you this weekend. May he help you and encourage you to be faithful with what he has said to you. Amen. Remember Cody and Jenna and their families as they have a special weekend. God bless you, church. Take care.